العالمين والآكبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين.
سبحان الله.
فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
سبحان الله.
إنما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم الأداوة والبغضاء والبغضاء في الخمر والميسر ويصدكم عن ذكر الله عن الصلاة فهل أنتم منتهون؟
سبحان الله.
وقال الله تعالى في مكان آخر: قل يا عبادي قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا.
سبحان الله. سبحان الله.
إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمين الرؤوف الرحيم. وقال الله تعالى في شأن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. Indeed, Allah and His angels send salutations upon the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. O believers, you also send salutation and salam for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa ashabi sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa barik wa sallim wa salli alayhi.
Subhanallah.
Ya ikhwan wa akhawat, my beloved brothers, my beloved sisters in Islam,
mashallah.
I start with the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam: afshu salama baynakum, spread peace and harmony amongst yourself. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My beloveds, I have been invited today here within Reading, the Islamic Center of Reading, to discuss and talk about a very essential and important topic, a subject matter. When this was mentioned to me, my first, of course, question was, the main title of this is Identity Crisis.
Allah, Allah.
And then with that, you want me to discuss and talk about those vices which, as an ummah, we might be engaged in. I started to reflect. I thought about this. I reflected over this.
MashaAllah.
And I wanted to start, and I wanted to set the scene with this particular saying. This is Malcolm X, Malcolm Shabazz, yes? The civil rights movement, one of the individuals who spoke for that in America. And I want to start, I want to set the scene with this saying: don't be in such a hurry to condemn a person because he doesn't do what you do, or think as you think, or as fast. There was a time when you didn't know what you know today. I want to start with this saying. I want to start with the saying of Malcolm X to make it clear to you that we are starting with a tradition of not being people who look down upon others.
Wow.
We are amongst that nation who looked after the weakest of the weak. We're amongst that nation that we help and support those who have fallen.
Amen, amen.
We're amongst that nation of people that our honor stands with those who have fallen, so we may reach our hand and extend our hand to raise them back up. My beloveds, today, inshaAllah ta'ala, my discussion, my conversation, my words, my statements, the research that has gone into this, in getting this information to you, I've gone out of my way to look into this subject very carefully. My beloveds, I desire your attention. Because what I have to say today at this pulpit, no doubt An-Nasiha, no doubt the Islamic Center of Reading has requested this to happen bi-iznillah ta'ala. But this is something which is dear to me, my heart. And of course I know it is to you. I'm going to discuss certain things. I'm going to put in front of you clear-cut facts. That's the reality of what is happening within this country, within Europe, to the Muslimin. At any time, you feel this is too much for you, I will never take it as offense if you would raise and you walk straight out. I have no problem with that. Because what I have to say is going to be burdenful. What I have to show you is something which I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will etch itself into your brain and into your heart.
Amen.
What I have to say today. What I have to say to you today is something that has brought tears to my heart and my eyes and my heart is crying, my beloved. What I have to say to you today.
Nare Takbir! Nare Risalat! Nare Hadri!
My beloved, I've been asked to talk about alcohol abuse, alcohol addiction, drug abuse, drug addiction. As you can see, at the front here, I've put up certain words. These are case studies. There's information on here which I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that after, once we have finished, we have discussed what we need to discuss, and our beloved Shaykh, inshaAllah ta'ala, Shaykh Muhammad Radwan, has said and shared his thoughts with us, bi-iznillahi ta'ala, that you will come around and you will read this. These are living examples of people who have gone through different type of negative experiences in their lives. Addiction. An addiction is clearly a condition. It's a state of mind, heart, body, soul. When an individual becomes gripped, or he becomes crippled, or an individual who is overwhelmed by, of course, the one that you know, the substances that they may take. May that be alcohol, may that be drugs, may that be whatever form that you know yourself. But addiction is not only addiction towards these particular substances. Addiction can also be a form of behavior. An addiction can also be because of certain types of activities an individual is engaged in. And they are so engulfed in that particular activity that the activity has taken over the life of this individual. My beloveds, there's numerous research on this. But when I was looking into this, when I was researching this, something came up very interesting. A lady by the name of Jude Wright. She's from America. She's an intellectual, a person who's well known amongst the intellectuals of America, individual who has worked extensively within addiction, discussion of the addiction, how people have become asphyxiated with a particular behavior, activity, substance, whatever it may be. She separates the addictions. She says there are addictions which are soft addictions, and there are those which are hard addictions. Hard addictions, as you would know, are addiction, for example, alcohol abuse, drug abuse, activities of this kind, the uses of substances of this kind. But there are also soft addictions. They are those habits that keep us from progressing. Those habits that we are engaged in that do not give us the ability to move forward. And we say, Yasidi, what are you talking about? What are these activities? These are her words, and I'm quoting her. They cost us money, rob us of time, numb us from our feelings, mute our consciousness, and drain our energy, and we all have them. What are they? They are particular behaviors. After your work, after your school, after your university, after your college, you sit at home, maybe in front of a particular device. May that be in front of your computer, may that be in front of your laptop, may that be in front of your phone. You are dedicating hours of the day, hours of the night, sitting in front of an idol. Let me use that word. Which you have become asphyxiated with. Only Allah knows and only your conscience knows what you are engaged in at that particular time. But that becomes an addiction. It doesn't say. Of course it does. My beloveds, there are certain individuals who cannot live without going out and buying something. They are always spenders. Our beloved sisters, and of course many brothers, who go to the shopping mall, who go to these temples, if I may say, temples of capitalism, to quench the thirst of having something new to wear today, so I can remove it and buy something else tomorrow. Isn't that right? What happens? That becomes an asphyxiation. That becomes an act that you have to live. You have to do to live. I know of individuals who have hundreds of pairs of shoes, hundreds of pairs of shirts, hundreds of pairs of clothing, and the amount of money that has been wasted. Allahu a'lam. But what is this? This is an addiction. That's what it is. You have become asphyxiated. I've got to buy that. I've got to get that. I can't live without them shoes, you know what I'm saying? I can't live without that. I need that shirt, man. What's wrong with you? I'm going to go down and buy it. I need it. Until you do not have that in your hand, you don't feel calm and collected. Isn't that a hit? Won't you call that a hit? Because an addiction is not only that you string yourself. It's not only that you sniff yourself. It's not only that you take a particular shot of something. But it's also when you do, when we engage in activities of this kind. Then we live in a society where drinking is part and parcel of social life. But my beloveds, there is a reason why people engage in these activities. There could be psychological reasons. There could be social reasons. There could be personal reasons. There are many reasons why people engage in activities of this kind. They find solitude in drink. They find solitude in particular type of drugs. They find solitude within an activity which is mundane, which is slowing them down. Their brain is slowing down. Their body is slowing down. But they cannot see the true impact of that activity. My beloveds, when we live in a society of this kind, we understand why people do what they do. But the intention is to get to the bottom of that problem, an issue, and to deal with it. Why am I saying this? I'm saying this because of the following reason. We look after the physical, don't we? We always look after number one. You always do that.
We always look after the body. I've got to look after my bicep, my triceps. You know, I'm going to get a six pack. Of course, I don't have one. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wasallam. I need to sort out my back. I'm going to go down to gym tomorrow. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to make sure that I pick up the weights and I sort myself out. I'm going to look after number one. But you know what happens, my beloved? We also have something called emotional health. It's called mental health. What's it called? Mental health. Now, emotional health or emotional hygiene. There's a psychologist by the name of Guy Winch who said something very interesting. I came across this just recently and I was fascinated with this study. And in fact, this study is so closely linked with the works done by our ulama al-kiram. It's amazing. The study says, like we look after the hygiene of the body. We go to the bathroom. After we've done what we need to do, what do? Wash our hands. We wash our private parts. We do, don't we? If we go and see someone who's ill, before we go there, we use sanitizers to cleanse ourselves. We make sure that no virus that this person catches, and we do not catch anything from him or her. True or false? We do that. Physically, be very careful. But we neglect mental, emotional hygiene. What are we talking about? We're talking about depression. Huh? We're talking about loneliness. We're talking about suppressed feelings. Emotions. We're talking about suppressed anger, which comes out in a very negative way. And what we don't realize, if we do not look into the hygiene of our brains, our hearts, our minds, our feelings, that has an adverse effect upon our bodies. And what happens? We slowly, slowly start walking towards those substances which are suppressants or stimuli. Suppressants, and alcohol is a suppressant. When a person takes a few shots, for a short while they feel warm inside. This is not my personal experience. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina wa maulana Muhammad wa barik wa sallim wa sallim alayhi. My beloveds, I say this through first-hand experience with people who are engaged in activities of this kind. Oh yes. I have seen, my eyes have seen this. Ya Wallahi. That is what I'm sharing with you. To get rid of them pains, them thoughts, them reflections, them worries, them concerns, what do? We walk down a path which of course ultimately will destroy us. For a short period of time, we take a few shots of alcohol. Maybe alcohol pops, which is very common amongst our young individuals. Oh, it's just a drink, man. Yeah, but look what happens afterwards. Or it could be starting off cannabis. Bro, man, gonna have that smoke. Yeah. It mellows me down. You know what I'm saying? Allah. My brother, you mellow at this moment in time. Let another half an hour, 4 minutes go by. Boom, you're back. The thoughts are still there. The worries are still there. The concerns are still there. They're not gone nowhere now, my brother. They've gone nowhere. They're still there. Why? What you did is suppress them. Or you were on a high. Maybe you took ecstasy. You were buzzing. You're on a high. You're on a climax. For a short period of time, you're out of that state of worry and concern. Guess what? You have not dealt with your mental health. That depression, that worry, that concern has not gone away. It has just been masked, my beloved. That's what's happened. That's the reality of what tends to occur. What the study shows, my beloved, is that these individuals, these people who do not look at the emotional hygiene, the cleansing of the self from within, a time comes at the age of 30, 40, 50, and I have seen this, my beloveds. My eyes have seen this. What happens? They fall so low on the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All they live for is that one hit. That's all they live for. And what I'm sharing with you, you might say I'm speaking hypothetically. No, there are facts behind what I'm saying to you. This is a reality of what is going on, my beloveds. Alhamdulillah, today that you are sitting here with the grace of God Almighty, right? You might be those individuals who are safe from this type of addiction.
Amen, amen.
But every single one of us can look into ourselves and say, you know what, I might be a person engaged in soft addiction. This is something that we need to reflect over. My beloveds, in our Deen al-Islam, there's a particular tradition which I'm going to share with you today. And I want to share this tradition because I feel it is highly important for the mu'mineen to understand that the deen is there to help you. Our Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has given us this particular deen to save us. That's what it's there for. You're young men and women. You have thousands of questions. How do I live? What do I do? What's my purpose? What am I here for? Why should I do this? Why should I engage with this? What should I do? How should I do it? Etc, etc, etc. You desire the answer for these questions. Just like you, there were the great Sahaba who come to the bargah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam desiring answers. Just like that, Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Khalifa Thani, the second Khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Hazrat Mu'az bin Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in Madinah al Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say to Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inform us, tell us about the vice of drinking alcohol and engaging in gambling. They asked him this question. Okay, what is the stance of the believers? What is the stance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What is the stance of Sharia concerning these particular vices? Because at the time, there was no ruling on this. As this question was asked, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sent the verse down in Surah Al-Baqarah, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. So Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they ask you, they're asking you a question concerning alcohol and gambling. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala indicating towards the discussion between Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now listen to this. قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ. Tell them, inform these individuals, say to these individuals that both of these vices, both of these activities, both of these, let me use addictions, have great sin in them. There are many disadvantages within them. Yes? You say, yeah, also that's obvious, isn't it? But then listen to the next thing. وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. But it also has benefits. وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْئِهِمَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the disadvantages or the losses within it or the ism within it, the sin within it is greater than than its benefit. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing here? If you look into the process of rehabilitation and detox, what you find is that the first step is to realize that what I'm doing, there's something wrong with it. The first step. The question has been asked, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is the stance of Ad-Din al-Islam concerning alcohol drinking and engaging in gambling? Allah Ta'ala says that both of these activities have what? There are elements within it which are harming, and there are elements within it which are helpful and supportive. There are aspects of that. But the ones that are harmful are greater than what can help and support you. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing? That individual who has become asphyxiated with this particular substance or this activity, firstly you have to make him realize, well, what are you doing, my bro, my sister? Fine, we get it. You're trying to get rid of them pains in your heart, man. You're trying to get rid of all them feelings of hurt and pain. We get it. But my brother, this is gonna destroy you. And this is the reason why. The studies, the numerous studies out there. How it affects the liver, how it affects the heart, how it affects the other parts of the body. How it affects your long-term memory, how it affects your brain. Very ajeeb or gharib illnesses a human being will get just because of drinking this particular substance. And according to the Holy Quran, Qawla Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is Ummul Khabais. It is the mother of all filth. This is the reality of this. When the Sahaba Ikram heard this, some of them straightway stopped. They had that will to stop. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has told us, informed us, that there is some benefit, but there may be disadvantage within it. You know what, I better stay away from this. But there are people who kept on drinking. Then an incident took place. Hazrat Abdul Rahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu, another Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, invited some of his friends over for a meal, as we do. Well, come on, let's go down and let's go for a bit of a scrum. I think this is a northern thing what I just said. Sorry guys. What I mean is, let's go down and let's go for a bit of a meal. Yeah. So this is the same thing what the Sahaba did. The Sahaba Ikram, Hazrat Abdul Rahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu, invites his friends over. They have a nice meal. And it's a tradition amongst the Arabs, they would also drink. Yes, they would. Like in Europe at this moment in time, look in France, look in other parts of the European setting, where drink, alcohol, etc. is part and parcel of their society and social life. This was the same thing. But then it was the time of Maghrib. Hajjah alayhi salam. Come towards prayer. When they heard Hayya ala Salah, of course they would stand up and go and pray Salah. So this Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked one of his friends to go forward, one of the Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to go forward and to lead the prayer. When he started to lead the prayer, he read Surah Al-Kafirun. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ. Say to the kuffar, we do not worship what you worship. وَلَا أَنْتُمْ أَعْبِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. Alright? We do not worship what you worship. You do not worship what we worship. But guess what? Because he was under the influence of this intoxicant. Because he was under the influence of alcohol at that particular time, of wine or whatever he had taken, he said it the other way around. What you worship is what we worship, and what we worship is you worship. Oh my God, the Quran al-Kareem. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala sent the second verse. And you remember this verse comes in this next surah. Allahu Akbar, in Surah An-Nas. Nisa, Surah An-Nisa, sorry. In this particular verse, look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says.
Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la takrabu salata wa antum fuqara.
O believers, or those of you who have iman, 1 minute, talking to the people of Allah tabaraka ta'ala, right, talking to the sahaba, talking to the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when this particular incident takes place, that he says wrong verses, or the other way around, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala straight away sends this particular verse of the Holy Quran al-Kareem, that O believer, la takrabu salah, do not go close to prayer when you are in a state of intoxication.
Yes.
I was looking into, and this is something, it's part and parcel of my job as well, which I relate and deal with. Detox and rehabilitation. Detoxification and rehabilitation. Keywords. One, after the individuals have acknowledged, you know what? Whatever I'm taking is not good for me. So they come to an acknowledgement, self-acknowledgement. What I'm engaged in is going to harm me. It's affecting me. It's dragging me down the wrong path, my brother. Then, because this verse, second verse has come in a completely different surah, there was a time period in between. And if you look at the process of detox and rehabilitation, they give you time. So you may distance yourself from the grip, right, control of that substance. Then what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? You got to control, you have to take control of that addiction. How do you do it? 5 times a day, stop drinking. This is the Quran. You drink through the day, through the afternoon, in the evening, at night, you're at it all the time. Because this incident took place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying what? 5 times a day, stop. When you come to prayer, do not be in a state of intoxication, under the influence of any substance.
What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing?
He's giving you control back, little by little.
Masha.
My brother, you used to smoke 20. Come on, my bro, do 15. You know what? Reduce it to 10. You know, let's do this after about 2 weeks' time. Make it 5. Slowly, slowly, inshallah, ta'ala, you come down to 0.
Amen.
That's the process. It's a gradual, slow process. Why? Understand what I have to say to my beloveds. Who created us? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Who knows us? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Who created our nature? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created our nature. He understands when we become addicted to something, when we become asphyxiated by something, that will totally, completely engulf us. Who knows that? Every single year, He gives us control back on our food and water, doesn't He? What am I talking about? I'm talking about Ramadan. He gives Ramadan, didn't he? You know what he's done that for? One of the reasons behind it, of course, to become close to him, one of the reasons is to give us control back to us. Those who are gluttonous, those people who live to eat, not eat to live, they become addicted to food. It's an addiction. Isn't it? What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? That He gives us Ramadan al-Mubarak to give us control back in our hands, the margin lines, control the amounts that you take within your bodies.
SubhanAllah.
Your drink that you're taking, the food that you are taking, the time that you are consuming in your life. How? You wake up a certain time, you sleep at a certain time, you have to go to Salah, you have to go to Namaz, you have to go and do Zikr, you have to go and do Fikr, you have to do all of these activities. Allah said so.
Do it.
Through Ramadan, He does that. What is He doing? He is making a structured system for you.
The same thing here.
He's saying to the Sahaba, he's saying to the companion, he's saying, of course, ultimately to all of us, okay, when you are in state of in addiction of something, throughout the day, reduce it slowly. So five times a day, do not be in a state of intoxication. Now imagine, before they come to Salah, what's going to happen? They're not going to drink. They're not going to try to get that hit. Because Allah said so, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what happens? Straight away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is creating an opportunity for them to remove themselves from the addiction, the grip, the control of that particular substance. That's what he's doing. But in a very beautiful way. There were some Sahaba who of course heard this. And because they slowly, slowly started to, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, five times a day, they didn't do this, the grip, the control of that particular substance slowly loosened.
Subhanallah.
So instead of having, not only having it five times a day, they stopped having it in the daytime, in the afternoon, in the evening, at night. So some Sahaba kiram became free from that. But still it was not haram. It was still not haram. There were still people who were socially drinking, who were still engaged in these type of activities. Then, the third and the final verses of the Holy Quran al-Kareem come down to completely seal the deal about the prohibition of alcohol. What happened? That Hazrat Uthman ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu invites us once again some of his friends home. This is another Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He calls them, and it was amongst their tradition. Once they've eaten, once they've drank, they will sit back and make poetry. Like we sit back, listen to maybe nasheeds, or maybe listen to someone's taqreer, or maybe, you know, whatever activities you get up to, my brothers and my sisters in Islam. May Allah keep you halal. But they did the same. So what they did was, they would sit and they would, in poetry form, they would talk about their clan. Okay, we are great people, we are amazing people. I'm from this clan, I'm from that clan. I'm honored amongst men, and I'm honored amongst the Arabs. They would talk about this in a poetic way. But at the same time, whilst they were honoring themselves, they would make poetry and poems and prose. Do what? By belittling others. Yeah, I'm better than you. Guys, you know the mama jokes, don't you? How people try to put other people's mothers down. Yeah? It's a similar type of way or tradition that there was. And what happened? Hazrat Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu was sitting in that gathering. Sahabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said something, he made a couplet against the Ansar, the friends of other helpers. There's a young man who's walking by, who's from the Ansar. He overheard them. When he heard them, he became angry. Of course, naturally. Someone is belittling him. It's just human nature that you react in a particular way. I do remember, he's saying this. The Sahabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioning this under the influence. Because he's had a few, his tongue has become loose. So Hazrat Ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, what happens is that this Ansar takes a piece of bone and he throws it at him. And it comes and hits him on his head. When it does, it wounds him. Of course, there is altercation of certain statements made of dislike and hate, whatever. But he takes this complaint to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he takes this complaint to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that this is what has happened, ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tawajjuh towards Allah tabaraka ta'ala. And he says to ya Allah, give us clear cut guidance concerning alcohol, gambling, and these type of vices. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, sends the final verses which seal the deal.
Subhanallah.
The verses of Surah Al-Ma'idah. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي أمين رؤوف الرحيم. All you who believe, strong drinks, alcohol, khamr, games of chance and idols, and diving of arrows. There was a tradition amongst the Arabs, we would say like a betting, that how many arrows, if it's this many arrows, I'll get it my way. If it's the other way around, you will get your way. There was a bit of a tradition amongst them, of chance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all of these activities are rijsun min ash-shaytan. They are what? They are the handiwork of the shaytan. They are the doings of the shaytan. They are there to tempt you to come towards the path which is wrong and false by the shaytan. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, stay away from them.
Amen.
Abstain from them. So straight away Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stating this. Then he says something very important, relating to the incident that has just taken place. What does he say? إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ يُوقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَ وَالْبَغْضَاءُ. Look what he says. He goes, indeed the shaitan, indeed this particular open enemy of yours, he will create enmity and hate amongst you. How? Fil khamr wal maisir. When you engage in alcohol, consuming of alcohol, and engage in the activities of gambling. That's exactly what happened. After they had done what they had done, they had eaten, they sat down, they had drank, what had happened, their tongues had become loose. They started to say words of hate towards someone else. They had overheard them that created animosity. It did. And my beloveds, this is what these particular vices do. But this is the final step in the process of rehabilitation, the process of detoxification, where the final is the seal. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the Sahaba al-Kiram, they understand the elements which attract you towards this particular vice, and elements which make you a person who's addicted to these particular vices, the grip has gone. The control has gone. What happens? Once the control is loose, now they have distanced themselves through the second verse, slowly, slowly, with the grace of God Almighty, moving away from that particular substance. Finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now it is unlawful. There's a reason why I'm sharing this with you. And there's a reason why I started with the words of Malcolm X. Because there are individuals amongst us, we cannot expect change like that. Instant change. We cannot expect that. We can't expect people. And this is the reality. So whatever type of activity they're engaged in, overnight to change, there are people who have strong willpower. There are people amongst us, alhamdulillah, you should smoke 20, boom, straight to zero. There are individuals like that.
But I have seen the impact of people who are alcohol abuse. Now they're on Librium. It's slowly, slowly weaning them away from taking alcohol. There are people who are addicted to heroin. And because, as you know, there's a lot of people who die because of syringes and etc. And in the system, in the country, we have something called maintenance. The process of maintaining someone. In the place of heroin, they will take methadone, as you would know. Just to maintain them. The buzz is still there, the hit is still there. But to wean them away from the deadliness of that particular substance. This tends to happen. In the same way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does this in the Holy Quran al-Kareem. There are two images here. The outline of images. There's an outline of a sister and an outline of a brother. Let's call the brother Abdullah, let's call the sister Aisha, for example. These individuals, they might be you who's sitting here. Or they could be people that you know. There could be people who are in your families, there could be people amongst your friends, there could be people that you associate with. I want you to think about this. These two individuals are beloved to their families. These two individuals are people that their family look up to. Their mother and their father have all these dreams and aspirations concerning them. Their mother and father have worked hard to get them through college and then go towards university. They put the effort and time into their children. They provided for every need that they ever asked for. They provided. Apparently, these two individuals are ideal examples of daughter and son, brother or sister. But there's a hidden secret. The hidden secret is they're addicted. Maybe in the case of the sister, it started when she started to go to college. It started the drug of tobacco, slowly, slowly went toward weed. In the case of the brother, maybe it was in the secondary school, the final years. These two individuals are some individuals who are significant to you. It might be you. Your family has many dreams for you. Your family has many aspirations for you. They want you to do some wonderful things. They want you to take their name and make their name Roshan. Guess what? There's a hidden secret which is eating away at you, which is destroying you, which is slowly, slowly killing that dream of your parents, of your mother, of your father.
Allah.
But you are scared. You think, if I told someone about this, if I spoke to someone about this, they're going to look down upon me. They're going to say, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, you're Muslim. How dare you engage in these activities? But what did I just share with you? I just shared with you the process that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to detoxify the Sahaba from alcohol. Am I right or am I wrong? Didn't he do that in the Quran? My beloveds, there's a reason I'm showing you this. If this is you, don't fear. If this is you, don't be scared. Come, tell us. Speak to us. Converse with us. We will never look down upon you. We are not amongst them type of people.
Mashallah.
We are the people of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We love you, ya wallahi. We love you, wallahi. We love you. He was a great Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was an Ansari, he was a helper of those who migrated from Makkah to Al-Mukarimah to Madinah to Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This person, that's who he is. He's a person who participated in great ghazawat. He's a person, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, that he used to make Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam smile. That's who he is.
He had addiction.
He did. He had an addiction. He will last two to three times because of alcohol abuse. He was brought into the Baghdad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and last because of consuming alcohol. And it becomes so much that Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu couldn't take this anymore. And he said to him, La'natullahi alayhi. May the curse of Allah be upon you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was listening to this. Isma kalami ya khwana. Listen to the words that I am going to share with you. La tal'anuhum innahu yuhibbu Allah wa rasulihi.
Subhanallah.
Yaqul Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do not curse him. Who is that? Who is saying this? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And who is he saying it to? Allahu Akbar Kabira, the individual that when he walked on this side, the shaitan walked to the other side.
They're
saying it to him, they're explaining it to him, they're telling him, La tal'anu, do not curse him. Innahu yuhibbu Allah wa rasulih. Indeed, he loves Allah and his beloved Rasulullah. Ya Sidi Ya Mawlai. Mahazal Kalam is a person who engaged in alcohol, is a person who was punished for his abuse of alcohol. He's a person, he was known, and I'm going to be very careful in using this word, a person who was a bit of a prankster. He was a person who brought smiles onto the face of Sahaba and the soft line of the face of Rasulullah, the beloved face of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hate the sin, not the sinner, my beloved. This is an example in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Are we better than Rasulullah? I'm asking you. Are we better than Rasulullah? No! No one is better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is saying this. No doubt. There are many hadiths of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam which talk about the vice of alcohol, the creep of alcohol, the haram element of alcohol. He talks about it. A person who consumes it will burn within fire of hell. There's no doubt, there's numerous hadiths of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave an open hukam that
that this person should be punished because he is a person who consumes in alcohol. And let me share this same hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Like the person who drinks, the one who takes it from one place to another, the one who sells it, buys it, all are under the same ruling. So it is a sin. It is a sin. It is a sin. But how do you deal with this sin? Do you look down upon the person who will drink and say, oh, I'm better than you? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his teaching is what? If they are the ummatis of Rasulullah, and if they are the Allahu Akbar Kabira from within the fold of Adin al-Islam, help them.
Amen.
Help them. Well, I'm going to show you now, you might say, Sidi Mawlai, what's wrong? That's Ghalib. Who knows Ghalib? Do you know Ghalib? Okay, come on. Listen, I'm telling you straight, I know the movie, I've seen this movie, and it's a crazy movie. You might think it's a bit boring, I don't care. Unless you've read the Lord of the Rings, mashallah, Allah give you barakah, bismillah ta'ala. But I'm trying to explain something to you. You see that image? That's Gollum. That's Gollum in a state of immense asphyxiation for his precious. He became addicted to that precious, that ring. And what did the ring do? It gripped him, didn't it? He lived for that ring. He lost his friends, he lost his family. Hobbit, if I'm correct. That's the type of creature he was, or human was, or whatever he was. Look at him. He had hair. Mashallah, looked like a normal human being. Didn't he? But because the precious had taken over him, what happened? He lost his hair, he lost his color, he lost everything. Can I share something with you? I have seen, and I'm standing at the minbar of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I have seen many golems in my life. Not only on the movie. I work in a prison structure. I deal with individuals on the detox wing. Muslim, non-Muslim. Look what I said, Muslim. Pakistani background, Bengali background, Indian background, Arab background, whatever background they are from, whatever nationality they are from, originally, Lavan. That is insignificant at this moment. Bottom line is, they're Muslims. They've come in, and when they come in, they look like this. Rang pura hua hai. Mehsoos ho raha hai ki zindagi usme nahi hai. Main soch raha hoon, main to milne ke liye gaya. अरे इसकी बीवी है क्या नहीं, बच्चे हैं क्या नहीं, ये तो कुछ नहीं है, तो सर पर रहने वाला है. I'm thinking to myself that I've gone to see this human being. He's lost his color of his face. He's lost the strength within his body. Does he have a wife? Does he have children? Does he have any life outside of here? Could that be possible? And let me share with you. When 2 weeks go by, I start seeing the color in his face. Rangi chal janda. He's under detoxification, detox. Slowly, slowly, the grip of that substance is removed away from him. Slowly, slowly, his color comes back into his face. Slowly, slowly, the slurred word that he was saying and mentioning when I met him first time, I couldn't make out what he was saying. Now they become more clearer. He's saying, could you please call my wife? I need to tell her that I've come into the prison. Could you please tell my son? Could you tell my daughter? Could you tell my family that I am coming to the prison? Once again, I've hit the lotto. I realized, man, he has a wife, he has family, he has children, he has everything. If I hear so much wealth, it's shocking. But because of whatever personal reasons they may be,
he has fallen from grace. There's a reason I'm telling of this. It is possible to go from there to there. But it is possible to go from there to there. Yes, it is. It is possible. Ya akhwan wa akhawat, I give you stats upon stats what's happening. I went to my, it's called the DARS team, the team that deals with drugs and alcohol abuse within the prison structure. I sat there and I said to him, could you please tell me how many people have taken help and support from this service amongst, full completely in the last year? It's 1,398. Out of them, then I asked, what about Muslims? Therefore, we don't have religion. Right? But we can give you nationalities. So they gave me Pakistani, Indian, Bengali, and a few others. And the number came down to, for alcohol abuse, was 18 individuals. For heroin abuse, it was 24 individuals. Yes? Amongst them, as I can see, majority of you are from the Pakistani tradition, six of them were Pakistani who came for alcohol abuse, and nine of them for heroin. If you look at the numbers, it might not sound a lot. Now multiply that by 150 odd establishments. And you remember, these are people who access the service with choice or have been referred to. That's a large number if you multiply it. 150 establishments. That's huge, man! They are gripped by these particular vices. What does that say? What does that say? Please say. Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was asked, a believer, what is the status of a believer? Al-mu'minu bayn al-rahma. That a believer is balanced between mercy and fear. On one side is fearful, may my Lord not become displeased with me. On the other side, he has full hope in him. That my Savior is he. My guide is he, my light is he, my name is he, my honor is he. Is hope. There are numerous organizations out there which will help. You must have heard of the Christian organization, Alcohol Anonymous, AA, yeah? You've heard of some here? There are also Muslim organizations which are based on a similar structure. And I'm going to emphasize this again. You called me especially for this. So I've taken it very seriously. And I hope that has come across very clearly. But at the same time, I'm telling you this. My beloveds, there is hope. There is support. There is help. There is an opportunity for you to become a better human being. My beloveds, and I want to say this very clearly to you. You have to make ahd with yourself. My time will be over. It's over already. Just a few moments. You have to make a promise to yourself. The promise is this. For the last few years, I've destroyed myself. Last few years, I've harmed myself. Last few years, I've hurt myself. Last few years, I couldn't find that light at the end of the tunnel. But today, I want to do something about it. I want to read something to you very quickly. It's a poem. This poem, I was speaking to my brother yesterday, and he goes to me, my name is Imran anyway, okay? He calls me and goes, Imran, I want you to read this. And I go, I will read it. I want you to listen to this, please. I destroy homes, tear families apart, take your children, and that's just the start. I'm more costly than diamonds, more costly than gold. The sorrow I bring is a sight to behold. And if you need me, remember I'm easily found. I live all around you, in schools and in town. I live with the rich, I live with the poor. I live down the street and maybe next door. My power is awesome, try me, you'll see. But if you do, you may never break free. Just try me once and I might let you go. But try me twice and I'll own your soul. When I possess you, you'll steal and you'll lie. You'll do what you have to just to get by and hide. The crimes you'll commit for my narcotic charms will be worth the pleasure you'll feel in your arms. You'll lie to your mother, you'll steal from your father. When you see their tears, you should feel sad. But you'll forget your morals and how you were raised. I'll be your conscience. I'll teach you my ways. I take kids from parents. I take parents from kids. I turn people away from God and I separate from friends. I'll take everything from you. Your looks and your pride. I'll be with you always, right by your side. You'll give up everything, your family, your home, your friends, your money, and you'll be alone. I'll take till you have nothing more to give. When I'm finished with you, you'll be lucky you live. If you try me, be warned, this is no game. If given the chance, I'll drive you insane. I'll ravish your body, I'll control your mind, I'll own you completely. Your soul will be mine. Your nightmares I'll give you while lying in bed. The voices you'll hear from inside your head. The sweats, the shakes, the vision you'll see. I want you to know these are all gifts from me. But then it's too late. And you'll know in your heart that you are mine and we shall not part. You'll regret that you tried me, they always do, but you come to me. You came to me, not I to you. You knew this would happen. Many times you were told, but you challenged my power and chose to be bold. You could have said no, 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 and just walked away. If you could live that day over, now what would you say? I'll be your master, I'll be your master, I will be master, I'll be your master. You will be my slave. I'll even go with you when you go to your grave. Now that you have met me, what will you do? Will you try me or not? It's all up to you. I can bring you more misery than words can tell. Come, take my hand. Let me lead you to hell. Signed by addiction. Signed by?
Addiction.
But I don't want to finish up. I want to finish up this.
قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ
SubhanAllah.
Say to my servant, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Mere bandi ko keh do. Who have transgressed, who have gone away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have hurt themselves, who have harmed themselves, tell them,
La taqnatu, la taqnatu, la taqnatu.
Allah, Allah.
Aye, aye, aye. Do not be in a state of despair.
Allah.
Kabra mat.
Amen, amen.
Do not
be in a state of despair. Do not be in a state of despair. Min rahmatillah. From the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'an. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive all your sins.
Subhanallah.
All of your sins. Be sincere to Him.
Amen.
Innahu huwal ghafur rahim.
Subhanallah.
This is Allah. Indeed, He is all forgiving, all merciful.
Subhanallah.
My beloveds, I want to stop at this point and I want to say to you, there is hope at the end of the tunnel.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah.
There is a light at the end of the tunnel. If you know someone who's harming themselves, who's hurting themselves, please, for God's sake, help them. It is an obligation on your shoulders. And it's an obligation upon our shoulders to, inshaAllah, ta'ala, to support and help you. My beloved, there's a lot of information here. And there's information outside as well, inshaAllah, ta'ala. Please look at that. Look into it. Take it. Speak about it, discuss it. I also have these, inshallah ta'ala. This is legalized. Spice is big at this moment in time. And guys are going crazy and girls are going crazy with it. Trust me. Right? Please take some information outside. How to keep yourself safe. How to stay away from this type of activity, inshallah ta'ala. Pick up is free, inshallah ta'ala. Also this one, guide to alcohol, inshallah. You might say, I'm just a social drinker. My brother and my sister, I start with social and it becomes a personal problem. Right? Try it, take it, inshallah ta'ala. I do have these as well. We're not naive people. We understand what's happening in communities. Please at least look at this one. Wa akhiru da'wana walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahabi wa barik wa sallim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive something which I have said, which was out of context, inshaAllah ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me tawfiq first and foremost to practice what I have just mentioned in front of you. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala give you strength. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you tawfiq to take something from here and practice it and support others. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.